So we were offline talking about Stalin and the evils of the Soviet regime.
Yeah.
One of the things I mentioned, I watched the movie Mr. Jones, but it's about the 1930s, Holodomor, the, what would you say, the torture of the Ukrainian people.
Yeah.
By Stalin. One interesting thing to me that I'd love to hear your opinion about is the role of journalism in all of this. And also about 1930s Germany. So what's the role of journalists and intellectuals in a time when trouble is brewing, but it requires a really sort of brave and deep thinking to understand that trouble is brewing. Like if you were a journalist, or if you were just like an intellectual, a thinker,
sure,
but also a voice of in the space of public discourse, what would you do in 1930s about Stalin, about Holodomor? And what would you do about Nazi Germany in 1937, 1938?
So that's really funny that you asked that, because currently how the book is structured, it's like, you know, books often follow a three-act structure, right? So act three is the 80s, act one is the 30s, and act two is going to be like, all right, let's suppose you were in the 30s. Are you just going to give up? Like, are you just going to be like, well, we're screwed? And you'd be right to say things are going to be very bad for a long time. Or are you going to be one of those few who are like, we're going to do something about this, and, you know, we're going to go down swinging? There are two books I can recommend, which are just masterpieces that are written by women that just are historians that are just superb. There's a book called Beyond Belief by Deborah Lipstadt. She talks about the rise of Nazi Germany as seen through the press. And what was amazing, and she does a great job empathizing with the press and understand their perspective, is we remember, and Chamberlain gets a bad rap, Neville Chamberlain, for kind of appeasing Hitler, because not that long ago they had the Great War. They had World War I, and they had the carnage that the earth had never seen before. And when you had people made out of meat meeting industrial machines, and plastic surgery was invented as a consequence of this, they're coming back mangled and disfigured. And for what? And this was a world where the Kaiser was the most evil person who ever lived. And we all had the Western propaganda about the Hun and all the rapes and all this barbarism and blah, blah, blah. So not that long later, when you're hearing all this propaganda, which was factual, about Hitler, it's like, we heard this. We heard this 20 years ago. This was all lies. Give us a break. And she has all the quotes from the different agencies and how they addressed it. Plus, they had very limited information. It's not like Nazi Germany was an open society where reporters can walk around, and they were under a lot of pressure as well, you know, in those areas.
And Hitler himself was pretty good at, he let some stuff slip, but usually he made it seem like he wants peace. He wants world peace.
Well, this was amazing. They were making the argument that because all these Jews were being beaten up on the street, this was the hot take of the day, that Hitler was weak, because since Hitler's a statesman and he can't control these hooligans, that shows his control and power is tenuous, and this is all going to go away.
By the way, I mean, Hitler thought that too. He was kind of afraid of the brown shirts or whatever. Like, he was afraid of these hooligans a little bit. Like, they were useful to him, but like at a certain point, like, yeah, they can get in the way.
Yeah.
That's why he wanted to get control of the military, the army, like their regiment. Like, if you want to take over the world, you can't do it with hooligans.
Right.
You have to do it with an actual army.
And then you had Kristallnacht, which was a nationwide pogrom. And then all the news agencies universally were like, oh crap, we got this wrong. And the condemnation was universal. So that book traces the West's reaction to what's going on there, and including the reaction to the incipient Holocaust, as people being, you know, what they knew, when did they know. There was not ambiguity about it. People, I think there's this myth that she dispels that they didn't know the Holocaust was happening, or they didn't care. They were aware, but they were already at war with Nazi Germany. Like, what? Literally, what else could they do at that point, you know, to rescue all these Jews? So that's a superb book. And Anne Applebaum, I think the book is called Red Famine, came out fairly recently. And she brings the receipts. And she's a, you know, this is something I really hate with the binary thinkers, where the people think, oh, you know, if you're a Democrat, you're basically a communist. They call Joe Biden a Marxist. It's just like, you know, she's a hard lefty. She's, you know, has TDS. But this book just systemically lays out what Stalin did.
By the way, I'm triggered by the binary thinkers. And for those who don't know, TDS0011 is Trump derangement syndrome.
Yes. So they, you know, forced the starvation on this entire population. And they, it's not only that, it's like they knew if you weren't starving by looking at you, that you were hiding food. So they'd come back to your house at night and break your fingers in the door, or take, burn down your house, and now you're on the street without food because you lied, because this is the people's food. You're a kulak, you're a landowner. And very quickly, a kulak, which meant like peasant landowner, became anyone who had a piece of bread. And this was systemic and ongoing. And many people in the press did not believe it. There was a British journalist, I believe, who got out of the train, Ukraine, like one town earlier, and walked, and he described all this, and he was mocked and derided. And this is just anti-Russian propaganda, because at the time in the 30s, this was socialism had come to fruition. This was a noble experiment. I'd seen the future and it works, as I think Sidney Webb was the guy who said that. And the premise was, let's see what happens. We've never tried something like that. And they were perfectly happy to have this experiment happen overseas at the price of the Russian people, because it's like, you know what, maybe this will be paradise on earth. And there's a, I address this in my book as well, there's a superb essay, I think, by Eugene Genovese. And he talks about the question being, what did you know and when did you know it? What did you know about the concentration camps? What did you know about the starvation? What did you know about children being taught at school to turn in their parents for, you know, having some extra bread? And his conclusion is, we all knew, and we all knew from the beginning, every bit of it, and we didn't care because we were more interested in promoting this ideology. So when people are kind of thinking the worst thing on earth is like Robert E. Lee's statue being taken down to Washington, D.C., we were being told on a, and especially a much more limited news information world where now you have literally anyone can have a Twitter, but how many outlets were there? That this is, we're backwards, they're the future, they're scientific. We have the vagaries of the market, which led to the Great Depression. And when you see what was being put over on the American public at the time, anyone who thinks things are as bad now as they've ever been is simply delusional or ignorant.